Hi there again. I'm going to continue recording from where we left off on the first video. So here we were talking about the first question, the respiratory system. I was talking about how it filters. That would be part of homeostasis. We're bringing in the oxygen our body needs, getting rid of the wastes. Good. Two, critical thinking. Why do we need to ingest food? Again, I would say you can make an argument for all the different processes. And three, critical thinking. A virus, it's debatable whether a virus is alive or not. As long as you use logical reasons for putting whatever you put on, I would accept it. Virologists, scientists who study viruses specifically, don't know the answer. Let's go on to homeostasis. Every chapter, we will have a portion that focuses on homeostasis. Homeostasis is a condition of equilibrium, or balance, in the body's internal environment. What does that mean? It means keeping everything in our body within an acceptable range. So a normal body temperature, 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit, 37 degrees Celsius, is considered normal. But as long as your body's somewhere near there, it doesn't have to be exactly 98.6 to be considered normal. As long as you're not too far away, you're within an acceptable range. So we want to monitor our body's environment and make changes as necessary. So that's homeostasis. We use these regulatory processes, monitoring our environment, making changes to maintain it. We'll look at the types. This probably isn't the most important part for us right now, but homeostasis and body fluids, for an example, for homeostasis, you need normal water levels throughout your body. You need normal salt levels. We're constantly shifting fluid from different areas. We have to do so in a regulated manner to maintain homeostasis. There's a nice interaction. I suggest you click through it. It goes along with the textbook really well. Okay, so how do we control homeostasis? First, you have a stimulus. So for all the variables we're monitoring, oxygen levels, blood pH, body temperature, for all those, you can have stimuli, like increased body temperature, decreased body temperature. Those are monitored by receptors. The receptors, like thermoreceptors for temperature, take in this information, and they send it to control centers. That's going to be the brain or spinal cord, part of the nervous system for sure. The nervous system takes in that information and decides what to do. So it sends information out of the nervous system to effectors. Effectors affect change. They make something happen. So that's going to be glands that can release hormones or muscles that can contract. And that way you've got a response. Something changes. And hopefully we go back into balance. There are two types of homeostatic regulation. Negative feedback and positive feedback. Negative feedback means that when you have an original change, so like if your blood pH gets too low, you want to make a change in the opposite direction to bring into homeostasis. So there, if it decreases, you'd want to increase it back up. Opposite direction of the original change. So here's an example with blood pressure. So blood pressure, you're monitoring it. You've got baroreceptors. Baroreceptors are pressure. Baroreceptors monitor pressure. And when the pressure gets too high, they're going to get stretched and then send information to the brain. So the brain understands that our blood pressure is too high. It wants us to bring it back down. So it can do so in a number of ways. First way that it can do it is send information out to the effectors like heart muscle and the blood vessel walls. They have a layer of smooth muscle in them. They can make the heart rate decrease and the blood vessels can dilate. They can get bigger so that there's more space for blood and the blood pressure would decrease. Therefore, after an increase in blood pressure up here, we decrease it again, and we're back to balance. So that's negative feedback. Positive feedback is the opposite. Once we have a change, our body wants to keep going with it in that same direction. So, for example, here, you've got uterine contractions during childbirth. So once you start to have uterine contractions, they get stronger and stronger until childbirth. What happens is they stretch. That tells the brain to make them contract more. And you also have oxytocin being released there, which causes more contraction from the brain to the muscles until the baby's born. The other example that you'll see of this is blood clotting with platelets. Once you have a damaged blood vessel, you'll have platelets come in. And once they come in, they release chemicals to get more platelets and more and more and more platelets until you've formed a clot. Each chapter will look at homeostatic imbalances, when your homeostasis has been unable to be maintained. So there you can have disease, disorders, and if it gets too bad, death. Here are some more questions to review homeostasis. So go through those, pause, and then I'll answer them. What does the term negative feedback mean? That means when there's an original stimulus, like an increase in blood pressure, increase in pH, you want to bring your body back down. You want to go the opposite direction. You want to decrease your blood pressure, decrease your pH. And when the stimulus is something that's too low, like low oxygen levels, you want to bring that back up. You're going the opposite direction of the original change. Positive feedback, uterine contractions, platelets for blood clotting. Okay, last part, match the following. So this going through, it's your body responding to a decrease in temperature. So that's the stimulus. It's cold and your body temperature is dropping. The receptors are thermoreceptors that detect this change. They send it to your brain, the control center, that decides what to do. Its response is to send signals to the muscles. The muscles are the effector. They make the change. They contract. They release heat, and the result is your body temperature raises back to normal. Now we're going to start learning basic anatomical terminology, starting to learn the language of anatomy. First, body positions. Whenever we compare two parts of the body, we use anatomical positions. So that's, for instance, standing straight up, facing forward, arms down with their palms forward. Why do we use this? So that it's a universally known body position. We can always understand when we say something is superior above something else, we know that it means versus body position. So if you say the patient has a cut superior on their leg, you don't know what that means if they're not in body position. That could be different if they're laying down or on their side. Regional names. So different parts of the body have different names. We're going to get more into this in lab, but it's going to be very helpful for you to start getting down the names of different body parts. Once we get into bones and muscles, it'll be really helpful to know. Directional terms are the terms that we use to relate different parts of the body to each other. I've kind of alluded to this with anatomical position, but superior, inferior. Superior means above towards the head. Inferior means below towards the feet. Medial and lateral. Medial means towards the middle. Lateral is more towards the side. So there I would say the sternum is medial. The shoulders are lateral. If I wanted to say something in between there, I could say the ribs are intermediate. Medial, intermediate, lateral. Proximal and distal. Proximal and distal you only use when you're looking at two body parts on the same limb. So I'd only use it on arms and legs. Proximal means closer to the body trunk. Distal means further away. So you would say that the wrist compared to the elbow, the wrist is distal, the elbow is proximal. But if you were comparing the shoulder and the elbow, now the shoulder would be proximal and the elbow would be distal. Superficial versus deep. Superficial means more towards the outside. So usually you'll hear this with skin. Skin is more external, it's more superficial. Muscle is deeper, it's more internal. You would also see anterior, posterior, dorsal, ventral. Anterior means towards the front. Ventral means stomach side. So anterior and ventral in humans are interchangeable. Posterior, dorsal, means to the back. So like a dolphin has a dorsal fin on its back. Dorsal, posterior, back. You can also see contralateral and ipsilateral. Ipsilateral means two things are on the same side. So your gallbladder and your liver are ipsilateral, whereas your gallbladder and your spleen, contralateral. They're on opposite sides. Planes and sections. So whenever we do any sort of medical scan, looking at different parts of the body, we divide it down an invisible plane. When you divide the body into a left and right, straight up and down, that's a sagittal cut. Down the middle is mid-sagittal, can also be median. Anywhere off to the side a bit, still cutting the body into left and right, that's parasagittal. Para means to the side. A frontal cut cuts the body into a front and a back. Transverse is a horizontal line, cutting the body open in that direction. And anytime you see anything diagonal at all, it's oblique. Obliques means diagonal. So here's an example of looking at the brain through the different cuts. You're going to see different things. So if you cut it down the middle to a right and a left side, mid-sagittal, you've got this view of the brain. You can see the area where you connect the right and left halves. A frontal section shows you this view. So this is the corpus callosum here. You're getting a side view of it, and now you're getting a head-on view. And then transverse plane cuts it open along the horizontal plane. So now you can see inside this space where you saw the butterfly that way. Body cavity. We have cavities inside of our body with internal organs inside. They're more internal so that they can be protected. Oftentimes you'll find them behind bone, underneath bone, more deep. In yellow, you've got your dorsal cavity. That consists of the cranial cavity with the brain and the vertebral canal with your spinal cord. In the front, you've got your ventral cavity. That's divided into two main parts. You've got the thoracic cavity in blue and the abdominopelvic cavity in green. Within the thoracic, you've got two lungs, so that's your pleural cavities there. In the middle, all over the whole thing, you've got the mediastinum, and the bottom has the pericardial cavity. That's where your heart lies. Abdominopelvic cavity can be divided into your abdominal cavity, and at the bottom, your pelvic cavity, with like your bladder, portions of the anus, uterus for females, ovaries, or testes. Okay, surrounding these cavities, in the ventral cavity, you've got serous membranes. They're important for protection as well. There are two layers with fluid in the middle. So around your lungs, in the pleural cavity, you've got the pleura. Around your heart, the pericardial cavity, you've got the pericardium. They help lubricate so that it's easier for the lungs and heart to contract. It reduces friction. They can move easier. There's less wear and tear on those tissues. Here you can see a transverse plane view of a person. So here's the lungs. There's the heart in the front anterior. Around the lungs, you can see the pleura. There's the inner layer, the visceral layer, serous fluid, parietal layer on the outside. Goes all the way around the lungs. And then around the heart, you've got the pericardium. There's the space between the layers here. So when you're thinking about the serous membrane, you can think of it as putting like your fist into a balloon. There's the visceral layer touching the organs, touching your fist. There's a space that's going to be filled with serous fluid, and there's the outer layer, the parietal layer. So in your abdominal cavity, it's called the peritoneum. And that's really important for helping anchoring down your organs, like attaching your stomach to different organs and then the cavity wall holding it in place.